What up, man? We got Casual episode 81, Hieroglyphics, Carrying the Culture show. What up, man? And this is a great day. New joint drops. We're going to get right into that. So how you doing otherwise, man? You good?
I'm good. How about yourself? Everything good with you?
Maintaining, man. Just trying to maintain, you know. So excited to do this. It's Hiero week for us. We had A+. We got a new show with him. So we did that on Monday. Had Tajay on Wednesday. Got you. So it's been a fun week for us. So like you cap it off. So I'm excited about this because project's dope, man. You know what I'm saying?
Word up. Appreciate that. Yeah, it was fun too. Shout out to Dan Perry. But it was a real fun one to do. A lot of good fun stuff on there. You know what I'm saying? Thank you, myself, and all the people who participated in the project to help make it what it is. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, it's dope. So real quick before we get into it, if you got any questions for Casual, use the questions feature rather than the comments section. That way I can pull them up. Also, if you get any wild shit in the comments, I'll send your ass home. That's what it is. But yo, I did want to just jump right into the album, man. Like, so what's the energy behind it? You got some crazy features on there, like remixed a few joints. Like, what's the whole vibe behind it? The artwork's dope on the, you know what I'm saying, the cover art. So what's the deal?
It really is the Art of Reanimation, you know what I'm saying? Seeing that it's like a remixed album with like 5-6 new joints on there, 5 new joints on there, you know what I'm saying? That's what it was. And Dead Perry came to me with the idea to want to reanimate the record, you know what I mean? To like, yo, let's just see these lyrics in a different light. He like, I want to work with this body of material, but I want to redo everything. And so I was like, that sounded like a cool idea. He had the plugs and the connects with the vinyl and getting the connects with the cassettes and all that stuff hooked up. And so I was like, it's wonderful and beneficial, you know what I mean?
No, that's dope. How'd you originally link up with him?
Internet, man. Like, it was, especially during the COVID times, all we doing is internet action. I mean, you know, at least me, do some. I ain't meeting too many new people in real life. Just think about that. It's funny, right? Like, I done met most of the people I done met and done business with through means like this. And so, in the internet age, it happens just right online. You know what I mean?
Damn, that's dope. That's how a lot of connections are happening. And a lot of, you know, it's the positive and negative of the whole thing. Sometimes the internet is trash, and obviously you can, you know, do a lot of dope things from it. How'd you decide on the features?
Well, you know, again, I was just choosing people I like and shoot people I wanted to work with. You know what I'm saying? You know, I mean, just to keep it real, like when envisioning the album, certain people pop up in my head and I just like, see if you look that up. Well, I got to give shout out to my man, Just Jay, who helped me get Killer Priest and Ghostface on the album. You know what I'm saying? He took care of a lot of things for me. And you know, Planet Asia Tricep, we go back like a flow jack, you know what I'm saying? And my man, Dan Perry put together a lot of stuff too. He's a real producer, and I asked him to be in that regard. We got the difference between beat makers and producers. Mm. Motherfuckers be like, a beat maker just give you the beat and don't really put no input in on how the project should go. A producer, and he even stepped forward more like an executive producer too. But a producer is really going to be like, nah, I'm going to put him on this, get him on that. And Dead Perry did a lot of producing for this record. So shout out to him.
Yeah, big up Dead Perry. Hit me up, you know what I'm saying, talking about it and stuff, and was like, you know, what up? Heard the joint show. And it's like, it's definitely a well-produced, cohesive album. And we don't get a lot of that these days, man. And it was like, you know, it's like, wow, it's an hour. It's not 20 minutes, you know what I'm saying? What's some of your favorite joints on there? I want to play some of them. This album just dropped today. It's vinyls out, right? Can they
get vinyls out right now? They can order it right now. Links is up. Everything out. You can check it on all your, you know, on all the platforms. All this, they this, say. This is, you know yeah. what I'm saying?
Yeah. Out.
Yeah.
What's some of the joints you like on? I want to play a couple more. I love the on the app joint. Yo, actually explain this line to me, man. You said like could have signed with Diddy and him. I feel like you told me about this story before, but what's the deal with that?
That's just some, you know, hip hop talking shit, man. But really though, back in the day, on some shot. Love the Biggie, and I wish I could have met him. And if it was real, I probably would have signed with them. So what I said is just like some braggadocio shit. But the truth behind the matter is, when I met Matty C in 1992, he told me a story about how much Big liked me back then, and that he used to pull up on the corner of Brooklyn talking about, what y'all know about this? And to turn up some Casual and shit. And so that was a real proud staple in my life. And you know, you brag and you just say shit like that.
Oh, that's dope. Now, because you be throwing some stuff out there. So I was like, I didn't know if that was some real joint. So what's one of your favorite joints? So you got a bunch of dope joints over here. I like that campus shit. We're gonna talk about that campus shit in a little bit too.
But, I got a lot of good joints on there. There's one with self-titled on there.
Oh yeah, the video we just posted. That what's the name of that joint again?
I don't even remember the name. Keep it a buck, bro. Rough for cover. Yeah, that's right. Let me do something real quick. I'm gonna tap out so it could be bumping how I was bumping. Then let me come back in for real, because people should be able to hear it knocking right.
All so right, if so I don't get lost.
I want to hear it knocking. I want to experience it. All so right. Real, we're gonna do this for the people, y'all. If I tap out, it was knocking way louder, and I'll let you know through the chat if everything is right. Right. I'm right here, yeah. Listen to this joint, y'all.
The for scientists. Work. All right. Let it.
They had to run for cover, couldn't stand the rain. Take three shots to murder, then I land the plane. Both the searching for a pain is how they answer pain. Life keeps getting better, son, I can't
complain. You could do a whole set of stand-up and they'd probably stare. I'll say one punchline and burn the body hair on Fozzie Bear. Floridian swamp monster, flipping over boats and soldiers. Getting boatloads of hoes till I'm overloaded. Treat a shitty promoter like a toilet bowl floater. Intoxicated, toxic male, imagine if I float sober. In the kitchen, boiling chemicals you handle carefully. Not necessarily Sara Lee. It's a little drink I make called COVID Correct. It travels to your lungs, explodes out your chest. Then the acids start oozing, corroding your flesh. Burn you till you look like first prize at the Egg Roll Fest. C-Title got the best show yet. No dance crews or lasers. Jail style, make my knife with a newspaper. Chase your wife down while I'm off some shots of Milagro. Bitch ran past me, the wolf get past these hollows.
They had to run for cover, couldn't stand the rain. Take three shots of bourbon, then I land the plane. Both searching for a pain to try to answer pain. Life keeps getting better, son, I can't complain. But they had to run for cover, couldn't stand the rain. Take three shots of bourbon, then I land the plane. But searching for a pain to try to answer pain.
I waste time on white sand beaches. It ain't about age, it's about the point in space time your lifespan reaches. If I spread bad blood, it's to fight the damn leeches. Stay loaded, the raps coded like white man's speeches. Niggas bite my shit, be like, hey, Mike, can't eat this. Then they throw up. I'm like a cyborg, my right hand features small projectile missiles that shoot. Then they blow up. Rappers arrange a showdown and never show up. You know what? This would be a good time to show some humility and accountability. Grow up. I take three shots of bourbon and be towed up. Drunk texting my ex about the way you hoe up. So what? Get a whipping when I hit the damn bottle. Giving rappers lashes like Instagram models. If I diss your man, just call me Pistol Man Rollo. $1 million worth of game, get it, Rollo.
They had to run for cover, couldn't stand the rain. Take three shots of bourbon, then I land the plane. Both the searching for a pain is how they answer pain. Life keeps getting better, son, I can't complain. But they had to run for cover, couldn't stand the rain. Take three shots of bourbon, then I land the plane. But we're searching for a pain is how they answer pain. Life keeps getting better, son, I can't complain.
I'm disgusted with the most of you, Paul. I got interns under my wings that run to your squad. I'm impressed with like none of you.
Good choice.
I had to listen to that in the crowd one time, hop in the crowd to see if it was flapping. Hey, you know what I'm saying? Shout out for playing that joint though, for real.
He had to get a different perspective, the other perspective on it. Nah, I feel you. That was you had to get that because it's different when you come in. Facts though. Yo, that's a missile right there.
And that's a cool one, though. And I just like the fact that he brought some new shit forward like that. You know what I'm saying? Hook me up with these MCs, and you know, it's just fun. Y'all know how it is.
Yeah, no, it was dope. So, I want to get obviously a bunch of other things too, but you know, you're known for the lyricism and stuff like this. So, I want to get into your head a little bit, man. As far as like the creative process for you, like just like some cats, how's it? What's in your head going on when you're sitting down making a track? Like, how's it? I mean, just give us something, because I'm that's something that's been on my mind a lot since I've been hearing you spit.
So there's a lot of different chat. You know how we rhyme. The most important thing I think is about being comfortable and being able to allow yourself to be in your comfort zone. You know, whatever it takes for you to shine. Some people are in certain situations that don't allow themselves to bring the best out of themselves. It might even be a silly situation like you in the studio trying to write or come up with some shit, and your man is over in the corner talking about football or something, distracting your energy a little bit. It could be just that simple. But for me, I take that kind of serious, and I hardly even perform a lot like in front of people anymore. Like if I'm in the studio, I've done it my whole career. I've been a hell of people in the studio, but now I feel more comfortable to do experimentation when I'm by myself. And so I take that seriously. So I'll be in my comfort zone, right? And then now it allowed me to push the envelope with things that I would not even want to do if I had another engineer. If somebody else was engineering me or something, I'd probably be like, I'm wasting his time trying to figure this new style out. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But now, and that's one thing. And then, you know, when it comes down to the art of writing and just how we really do it, a lot of it is explained in the templates that battle rap has laid out lately, like the schemes they be talking about, the build-ups, all of those. I've trained my brain a long time ago to think in certain type of patterns. You know what I'm saying? Like real early in my hip-hop, I really liked the rappers who could come up with metaphors and shit. And then you can either make a decision at that point to not try to be one of those rappers or to learn how that's done and how some people can just think of them so easily on the spot and they be really deep and dope. And so I spent like maybe earlier, like, you know, 9th, 10th grade trying to figure out how Big Daddy Kane and them was doing that.
Right.
And I really put some thought into that. And now it's like doing a jump shot, or if you're going to the gym to do some drills or something, you automatically just know your moves that you're about to do. So new situations, I'm just giving a hoop analogy, new situations on the hoop court going to ride for you to still get that same move off that you've been running the whole time. It's just a new situation. That's the same thing with rhyme schemes and patterns. It's still a four-bar setup. You know what I'm saying? I'm just putting new words in there in a whole new way. I'm still going to hit you with a punch after you hear them four rhymes, sometimes, unless it starts getting predictable. But, you know, so we start getting into the science of it in that regard, and that's something I like to specialize in, too. You know what I mean?
No, that's dope, man. And, like, I don't know if we talked about this the last time when we chopped it up, but, like, you know, out west, you know, it was a different vibe in a lot of areas. I mean, Oakland's different from L.A., but I mean, like, as a youngin', like, who were your all, like, your fucking heroes, like, as far as, even out there, like, I mean, like, I'm curious as to where I want to know where the pen came from, even if it wasn't from, even local, you know what I mean?
Yeah. It was some local cats, but for me, competitively, it was about being as good as dudes in Hiro. Because we crew like that, but it was, you know, we was just, first we was just like friends, and like we coming outside and everybody say they rapping shit. And so you like, what? Like, you know, us niggas out here, I gotta go be the best, basically. And so we was bouncing off each other for years and wasn't getting out our circle. Besides that, every time we would kind of step out of that circle in the Oakland areas, nobody was even, it would just be crazy. So I was like, dang, we might be onto something, because every time we go anywhere, you might could go in the Bay, we had to start leaving all the high schools and going to battle people at Cal Berkeley, because it was more diverse and they had, yeah, we was high schoolers go sneaking in the club at Cal Berkeley called the beer, not the beer cellar, the bird cage on Telegraph back 92, 93, before we could even get in, to battle the rappers from all over the world. And so we start making our name with rappers that wasn't really even known, but they were, the Justice League. Let me give them their props. The Justice League, Swahili, Cooley Rank, a lot of brothers who was doing it. I'm talking about personally, regionally. But then, I can't look over the influence Too Short and them had on me, but it didn't have me wanting to bar cats up. That just had me wanting to be, like, popular. You see what I mean? Yeah. But now when we talk about names people know, I was more influenced by people I kind of turned out like. It's kind of crazy. Like, I don't want to say like that, but, like, Lord Finesse, I was, like really wasn't focused on making no hit single. I was trying to come out and make everybody know he gassing. And if even that was even a small percentage of people who knew that, I was kind of appeased with that. Chill Rob G, another rapper that people don't really know how he was giving it to him back in the day because they didn't even really get to hear his body of work. But he had some shit that when he wasn't trying to make a single or when he wasn't trying to, make something for the label, oh my gosh, he'd be going in harder than hella rappers in his time period. And so I was like, God damn, this dude, I was trying to see how he was doing it. Back in our humility, we all had a time where we really was just like, all right, I'm about to listen to this over and over and see how the hell he's doing this. You feel me? And these are some of the people I did that with. The obvious ones, Cool G Rap, Big Daddy Kane was my favorite for years. And then we met this is all before the De La Soul influence kind of curved me and the direction our crew was going in to show that you could kind of be different. And Dale was already, just giving his props already, he was like our leader. He already was like different like that. He was showing that, but they came out and affirmed that the path we was on, what he was doing, was like really something that could be viable.
Right. Yeah. And that was, back in the day, it was, see it again, like you've had, like, especially late 80s, on the same bill, you would have like NWA, X-Clan, Public Enemy, Big Daddy Kane, Too Short, like Roxanne Shante, everybody, and, like De La, Jungle Brothers, you know what I mean? Like, it was so many different, so much different variety back going on back then, you know what I'm saying? Which was, which was dope. Yo, you had mentioned before that you had the opportunity to ghostwrite for Will Smith. You didn't do it. Did you ever have you made like a career out of that? Some cats end up going down that road. That's something you do on the
rap? Not really a career. But yeah, I do write, you know what I'm saying? And I don't, I wrote this, that messed up. But yeah, I do write and I help people, but back to that mention, that was really, when we talk about owning your masters and publishing, that was an opportunity that came out of Zomba owning 50% of my publishing back in the day. So they wanted to get more burn out of what they could get placements on. So they was like, okay, well, we have him write some raps. But I was young and dumb and didn't see an opportunity like I should have. Shout out, others probably had that opportunity, but shout out to Will Smith and Jive Zomba, Sophia Chang, all the old school people who had us on back then.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard that before, but like, again, when you were like 17 or something, I think you said, or whatever it was, so.
Yeah, you know how it was.
Make some decisions. Yo, so you got an interesting IG page, and it's dope because one of the things that I rock with on your page is the outdoor stuff, the RV. I mean, I don't have one, the jet ski, like you go fish. Because I do that. I like going, I like being outside, and I appreciate that. I like a lot of you guys' videos outside and stuff like that. So I appreciate that. How'd you like just even being a city cat, get into like all that stuff? Because a lot of cats I talk to be like, oh, you're going to get killed going camping. I'm like, yo.
Man, that's crazy. That's crazy.
Cats don't, they don't leave the block. They be like, yo, you're going to get killed going to the park.
I even had times being spooked in the state park by myself where I had to be like, yo, this is the state park. It ain't like you in, like, Yosemite. I mean, that's different. But honestly, I moved to the country type area just to raise my girls and, you know, to get around the schools that we at, the school that we at. And then out of recreation, I mean, out of need for recreation, I wrote a book. I did hella stuff after moving out here, you know what I'm saying? Because my time opened up. And being outdoors is something that really is really like needed for like keeping my mental stability, keeping my morale up, and you know, not just getting caught with the sounds of the city. Like that's how the world sound. That's how our world sound, but that ain't how like the earth and nature sound, you know. So I'll be needing to just go hear silence for a minute, maybe hear some birds chirp, you know what I'm saying, and listen to the water, the river, bro, the sound of the river. Oh, I'll be ripping too. Hey, I'm one of them dudes. I know we all fuck with the bars. Tell the truth. Every rapper that heard beats in nature, right? You might even be in your house and the washing machine might be going, right? And then after a while, you be like, that's a beat by the sound of a zipper spinning in the washing machine. You know what I'm saying? Exactly. So I'll be in nature. I might hear something. I don't necessarily hear a beat, but I hear something that'll turn. I see it like a lyric and be like, oh, I'm going to kill him with that. You know what I'm saying? I might be out there and see how many strains of grass is on a hill, and I might just equate that to how many styles I got and be like, I'm about to go right there. You know what I'm saying? All right, you know. But that's how I like letting nature lead the way a little bit creative. Being out there.
Yeah, no, that's dope. Yeah, because I see somebody, I was talking to somebody, I think it was Fest or somebody, and I don't know what it was. I was like, we're casual. So I don't know how it came up. He was like, oh, he probably on the RV somewhere. Like, he'd be out or something. So I think that's dope, though, man. Because like you said, running water, like sound of natural running water, it does something for the whole thing, man. For real. That's so. And so you're an archer. You do archery too, right? Somebody said something about that. I see it in your bio too, right?
Yeah, I'm an archer. I'm an archer. I represent an organization called the Magi Archers. It's really like my study, research, and debate team. But in order to be calling myself something like that, I felt like I had to like really learn some archery. Like, how you gonna be calling yourself even with a name and then you don't know nothing about it? Like with hieroglyphics, I had to go learn some metal nature, the language. And with the Magi, I got a few things. If you want to go look back on my IGTV. I got a few good shots I caught on camera, you know what I'm saying, on there. Like, I split arrows before. I wasn't really even trying. I was just trying to be accurate. But splitting the arrow is when you take a shot and you shoot the next shot and it slices the last arrow in half, you know what I'm saying?
That's on your IGTV?
I got two where I came close on my IG, remarkably close. But I just split an arrow when I wasn't filming. But on some stuff like this, you know, we like to study the history, and I go in on the African history. I found out that it was some Nubians called the Magi, who was known, renowned for their archery skills. You feel me? Actually, the Arabs called them, Ramat al-Hadak, which means the eye smiters. Ramat al-Hadak, H-A-Q something, whatever, H-A-D-A-Q, Hadak. And so y'all can just Google what I said, and it'll lead you to sources on the Nubian eye smiters. And so I'm like, oh, this, when I learned the history, and then I'm telling myself that today, it gave me enough to want to go actually try to learn that skill. And that's another reason, not to go off on a tangent, but that's another reason why history serves us well. It's like you join a football team, right? And you never seen none of their games before. Now you just like you on a generic team, right? So it come to third and one and they're on the 1 yard line and they in the Super Bowl, what they about to do. But if you join the Seahawks, you're gonna remember that time with Marshawn and when they, you know what I'm saying? And this is how history serves us well in all scenarios. You feel me?
Yo, it's can we go back to We got to go back to that in a minute, though. We can go all over the place. Because, yo, they just talked about that on TV recently. That changed legacies. Like, Russell Wilson's legacy is different now. Everybody's legacy different because of that dumb shit.
Yeah. Yeah, and again, like, we got this information now, so if we come to that point, even in the sports arena, we'll know, yo, it's time to make a better decision. Well, again, you know, I think people see that analogy, though.
No, that's what's up, man. I just think it's cool because it shows that – you know, like, it is well-rounded. It's like, it's not just Casual the rapper, you know what I mean? And there's more to people than just that, you know what I'm saying? So I think it's dope. I see you doing like jet ski. You were showing how to repair something one day.
I got some old skis. Like, I'm about to get a new one, though. I feel like it. But I got, like, some skis that I'm trying to work on to make some old stuff fast. It don't be like I'm flossing or nothing. You know what I'm saying? It's like I'm taking something that every engineer at CEDU told me I couldn't do, and I already did a lot of it. I took one ski that was topping out at 57. It's at 68 right now, but that wasn't my goal. I was trying to hit 75 last summer just by taking it. I didn't know nothing about CEDU engines, bro. I just took it all apart, got on the internet, and was like, because it was COVID. Feel me? So I was like, by time COVID over, this motherfucker gonna be doing 100. And really just to be like we talked about, keeping your time occupied with quality time, not letting your brain be idle, keeping your stability right. I gotta be working. And so that's what it was at that point in time. But like I said, I don't be like, it ain't like money videos, just these. I got some shit. I put stickers on and drew little drawings on and shit. You know what I'm saying? So, but they passed them so people be respecting game. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Now, that's dope, yo. And you made a good point about, like, you know, you picked up during COVID. I talked to MCs that started producing during COVID. Like, my daughter started crocheting during COVID. It can make, like, sweaters now and stuff like that. So it's like, that's what's up, picking up, you know what I'm saying, another skill. Yeah, talk to us about HieroCoin, man. I want to get into that. I'm scared. I'm nervous.
It's nothing to be scared of.
I ain't got no money, man.
It ain't like that though. It's like we don't want people. I mean, you know, when you're helping build something, sometimes right now, if it was standard, if we looked at it like standard. Well, first, let me slow down for people who don't know what's going on, because I was about
to break it down a little bit, because you know, layman's terms.
Yeah, we're gonna give them our cryptos bar, HieroCoin bar on the Binance Smart Chain. Bar trades for BNB, which is Binance Coin. If somebody was interested in holding bar, they would go to PancakeSwap. They would have to hold some BNB, which is Binance Coin, and then they could trade it for bar. You see what I'm saying? Now, bar is scheduled to be the currency of the HieroCoin DAO. A DAO is a decentralized autonomous organization. And basically, we're putting together a DAO for funding the arts, because really we're just trying to affect hip hop, you know what I'm saying? And so one of the ideas came to me was like, man, this is a new way that people can fund their projects. Since normally right now DAOs are all governance based, community governance, meaning if you hold a certain amount of the coins, you get to vote on what happened with the Skrilla. But what they don't let happen is the people who holding the coin get none of that script. It just be all for the company. So I was like, why they do that? The way you freaky is, you feel me? I was like, we gonna twist that and make it so that the people who holding the coin, if their proposal is good enough and they convince 51% of the people to approve their proposal, then they get the funding in our token, bar. And so this is a system that's scheduled to bring scarcity to our coin, you know what I'm saying? And it's just me thinking that DeFi technology could be brought to the blockchain to help people out, to help us out, and it could be mutually beneficial, you know what I'm saying?
So, man, like, where's a good place for somebody? Because I've seen some of your videos on YouTube and stuff, and some of you, I've seen you talking, and you've done some lives on, and I try to pay attention. I've only dealt with any crypto stuff, like, a few years ago, like, this darknet dumb shit. Like, where can somebody go, like, to kind of get, like, some just general information, man, like, about, or, like, how do you, like, because now it's just, like, blown up so much over the past couple of years. It's, like, I feel like Chester Cheetah out here, man. Like, you know?
Yeah. You know, honestly, YouTube University is what I call it. But really, you got to know where you're going and who to look at. And there's one, well, they could teach you how to do almost everything on DApp University. You know what I mean? But that's more like for people who want to be technical to know how to build stuff. But if you go back in their learnings and their teachings, they got courses just teaching people what all the terms is. It's another place, Binance Academy. It's a glossary of all the crypto terms and shit. And a glossary is always a good place to start when you get in any field. You damn near, let's keep it a buck, if you know, you damn near can learn a glossary and go any place in front real quick if you're good at glossaries. You know what I mean? Like, say a motherfucker can remember a glossary hella good, he can walk right up in the doctor's someplace and be like, oh, yeah, no, we need the pseudical mooter or whatever. And I'd be like, you know all the terms. That work in all fields, and I recommend that in crypto too. Like, if you lost, some people can just start with the glossary. Because when we hear a lot of these terms, we don't be knowing what people talking about. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so I just favored it. So I see I'm on the pink. So we go to pancake swap. So I just favorited that one too. So you know, that's okay. So then is there like a certain amount of money that needs to be in there for something to happen? Like for a project to happen?
Oh yeah, okay, that's a great question. Thanks for asking. You refer to money in the DAO for a project to happen.
Right. Is there a threshold, like a certain threshold it needs to hit?
So we set up everything on percentages. I think that's a great question because you actually, yes. In order for everything to start, it's going to have to be an initial amount because how can we start at like 500 bones, you know what I'm saying? And so it's going to grow, but we got system to make it grow naturally. Anyway, by using some of our liquidity pool fees that are accumulated by people trading bar and just pumping them into the DAO naturally so that it'll be growing while people ain't even tripping off it. And cats might come back in 6 months like, oh, it's really some bread there now. And all we need is to get these approvals of the members. And so that's good. But aside from there being a start point, there also is a threshold for, let's say, arbitrarily in our contracts we're working on right now is at 2.5%, meaning that say it get up to 1 million, I guess somebody could write a proposal for up to 25 racks. You know what I'm saying? And so we have to have a number that keeps the DAO running and sustainable and realistic. Maybe at certain points your whole project won't be funded by the proposal, but it could just be a grant towards what you're doing. So I guess if at 1 million, tell me if I ain't super bad, man, but if at 1 million, 2.5% is $25,000, then at 100,000, what they get, 2,500? It seemed like that. You know what I'm saying? 2.5% of 100,000.
2.5%.
Yeah, that's right. Because 10% of 100,000 is 10 G's.
That's the right percentage.
Yeah. So that means, if it was only 100 G's in there, then people would know what should you be able to get more than 2.5? You could get 10 G's. That means it should have started going broke. And so it's set up right to where it's actually sustainable. And then we'll have dead periods and burnout periods. Like, if we did 3 proposals in a month, then we obviously know it's going to be a 7-day dead period before we could look at more proposals just to keep it from being exploited.
So right now, are you guys trying, like, have you done any projects yet? Are you trying to, like, are you doing, like, some type of push where you're saying, hey, we need to get to this amount to, like, start doing something, or is it?
No. So it's like this. It's like this, basically. Building a DAO, we got the smart contracts and everything. That's not the hardest part, and we already on our road. But dealing with the legalities and being an American and not being an anonymous project, we got different hoops and hurdles to hop through. We got, it's just not an A9 crypto project where you don't know who the owners is, anonymous. You don't know who the owners is. They just, and people just buying into it. We got to go through legalities. And one thing considering decentralized autonomous organizations is the SEC particularly targeted what's called governance tokens and said that they are a security. They labeled them as a security. And so we not tripping off. We got the technology. We know how to do it. We can spin up a DAO. I even had a test DAO, because it was only a test DAO, up and running so people could see how the thing would work. and they can test it with their own crypto. Like they can put crypto in it, and then they can see that, okay, they submitted a proposal and it all works. And so it's really about trying to do it right and legal. That's what, and those are the hoops we're trying to hop right now. One of the things I didn't want to be trying to do is be like the first approval that the SEC give out. Other people's have submitted, and I've heard of rejections, and I don't know how many approvals that went first. And so we set and putting our ducks in the row. And here's another thing. Wyoming is the only U.S. state that'll illegally allow you to form a DAO. Yeah, everybody else, like, forming the case, they forming in different islands and different places. You feel me? And so I'm like, we ain't trying to go through that because we high roll. We trying to do it the way that the U.S. is setting up for us to have to do it so that we can eventually have this running for amounts of times without no type of conflicts.
Okay. Yeah. I see what you're saying. Like, yeah. You got some different avenues to kind of navigate. I got it.
Yeah. I mean, and again, they're there, though. But the thing is, they got it's out here. We just got to do it right. And so we've been with our legal people and doing what it takes to make sure we set things up correctly in regards to HieroCoin DAO, you know what I'm saying? We got new ideas too to bring to the table.
Got you. Thanks for explaining that, man. Thanks for the intel. I'm going to look up some of those sites and just try to do the knowledge a bit. We got Casual Hieroglyphics, new album dropped today. We're going to play another joint too before we get out of here. I want to get back to the music for a second. Yo, what's one of, like, can you share, like, a memorable tour experience? Something that I'm sure you probably had something. Nothing that would be crazy, but just, you know what I mean? But just something that really stood out for you.
Man, I had hella wonderful tour experiences.
Keep going. Go on.
I had one that was just showing me that I also reference back to in my life when I try to regard the power of manifestation. Or when I think about, like, what dudes could do when they thinking together or something. So, because we had some weird shit happen one time back in one of our van tour days. Hey, if y'all got any questions, post them in the chat before we get up out of here. But in the van tour days, you know what I'm saying? I'm talking about early van tour days. Like, we was in a snowstorm. And we was, like, someplace, and for some strange reason, nobody in the crew wanted to go to the hotel we was booked to stay in. We didn't know why we didn't want to go to the hotel we was booked to stay in. And we didn't want to, something was just like, we was like, we ain't staying in that fucking hotel. We had not even been there yet, though, on everything, right? And so I wish I could remember the city, but it's snowing hella bad. We driving down a long ass street. Maybe the snow had like cleared up for a minute. We just driving on snow. We all in the van, and somebody, I think me and somebody else, was like, hey y'all, we just tapped in on some other shit. We was like, hey y'all, everybody think we ain't staying at this hotel. Let's use our mind powers on everything. And we just got silent, dude. This is some crazy shit. We just got silent, right? And, like, you know, you how you holding your hands. And yo, we was just sitting there. It seemed like we was fake meditating for the joke that we was pulling off. But we started getting serious with it. Because we was all really hella quiet for hella long. You feel me? Like 25 seconds. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's a long-ass time to be doing that joke. And all of a sudden, something just snapped us out of it. Like, you wouldn't even believe it, bro. And nobody believe it. Ask anybody in the crew about this story. Something just snapped us out of it. We driving. We keep straight. We kind of laugh at what we just did. We keep straight. We get to the motherfucking hotel. And guess what the fuck? Lightning had struck a transformer at our hotel. The transformer was on motherfucking fire at the hotel, and they wasn't allowing nobody to check in or stay there no more. On everything. Ask anybody in the crew, blood. That's like the craziest shit ever. And so when we got older throughout our lives, we'd be like, cats would be talking about their moment, like, we gotta tap in, like the one time. You know what I'm saying? But we never did it again. Like, we never tapped in that hard. I guess we never was on that much unison But this is a real thing that actually happened. Ask Pleak. He'll tell you. You know, shout out, please. Shout out, whole HieroCoin. You know,
yo, that's crazy. I didn't think you were going to tell me that because there's another story that I heard that I was heard about like the snow. I think somebody fell asleep or something, driving or something. But that's where I thought you were going with something. And then I lightning striking the.
Look, I think that should sound crazy, right? Well, so I mean, we had our eyes closed, and we didn't see the lightning strike, but we do remember something popping us up out of our. About of our little fake meditation, you know what I'm saying? It turned out to be real. But when we got there, those were the reports that lightning had struck, or the transformer blew up. Let's take the lightning out of it. The transformer had definitely blown up at the hotel we was at, and they wasn't letting us stay there no more. You feel what I'm saying?
The reason is, yeah, damn, that's nuts, man. I mean, but that's real. That's when you really... That stuff is possible, man, and that's real. You were in a zone for a minute, man. And
sometimes shit just happens, you know. It's just life. Like you be like, some shit happened one time, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Damn, I didn't think it was going there. Let's pull up a question before we break on out of here. We're gonna play another joint too. Hold on, let's see. We're gonna pull up, see what we got. Someone said. Read this. Loving the new joint, Black Egypt seemed like a shift in style. Can you say how or when your style has switched up?
Oh yeah, no, my style switch up. All right, let me say, style switch up every song. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, really, it's like at the level of mastery I'm on. Sometimes I switch up the style. I always switch up the style like 5-6 times in one verse. And now I'm not even giving them 16s no more. They get like hundreds, you know what I'm saying? So you're not about to spit 100 and be spitting the same style. It's just going to sound boring to people. With Black Egypt, the style I was spitting was just appropriate. Like, I really didn't even want to put that song on Spotify, but I was having an argument with a YouTube person about Egyptian history. And I'm really not on it like that song. The song is just propaganda from my standpoint. But if somebody wanted to dialogue on it, I think it was all people, all type of people in ancient Egypt that ruled ancient Egypt. But I just spit that kind of simply. I want people to be able to grasp what I'm talking about style just because I was in like a little YouTube battle. Not even a rap battle. It was a person, just a debater, and I wanted to have the advantage on them, so I made that song.
Got you. Well, no, that's dope. I mean, yeah, that makes perfect sense. She says style changes five, six times a joint. Somebody asked, was B-1000 a true story?
Nah, B-1000 wasn't a true story. That's funny. Shout out to my people going back all the way to Fear Itself album. A story I told called B-1000 when we was rolling through the Oakland hoods, me, Snoop, and what you call it, we went to 73rd in Lockwood. I made up a lot of that, and that was a lot. I wasn't a reality rapper. I was an imagination rapper. You feel me? And reality rap kind of came out and got popular right along when we was, it'll be a little bit before us, but it always been reality rap back to the message. Don't get it twisted. But it was always cats like Special Ed who could say, I got a dog, a frog with a solid gold bone, and we still thought he was nice. And so I was always an imagination rapper. A lot of the times when I told a story like that, it was some shit I just thought of. You know what I'm saying?
But does it need to make sense? So it's funny, man, because we go back in the day and listen, like, I loved it. We loved that joint, but it doesn't make any. Some of the stuff that Greg Nice has said over the years, like, I don't know, but it's dope. So, like, fill in the blanks for me, because, you know, like, I'm sitting there like, yo, Dizzy Gillespie, what? He did what? Like, and Orca, like, but it's like, it's fire. But I don't, it's hard sometimes as a fan. Like, if I'm being realistic, some of that stuff back in the day was like, but I don't know.
Yeah, I feel you, but it helped us get to this point. You know what I'm saying? It's like some stuff in every era that we'll raise, you know, we'll be like that too. But I hear what you're saying. I think it got us to the point, and I didn't like it when it went too far off. Like, I don't deal with the jiggity-jiggity. I mean, I like some concept Excuse me, I guess no one understood that. But I like some concept raps where they do a concept album and it's all imagination. That's cool, but it's tangents and extremes on everything, and often extremes ain't never cool. Like when somebody just go off overboard with the shit, you like you rapping right. about what? You making up words almost. You know what I'm saying? Rapping about stuff in the cosmos that ain't nobody even thinking about. You know, you could go way too far with it too, but that's just the extreme example of everything. And I feel that same way about reality rap. The extreme, and they, but they own that though. They go too far with it to where they snitch on themselves, right? You know, you're going too far with telling the truth while you spitting, bro. You spoke the truth. Let's say something to the youth. The truth is always powerful, but the truth ain't always appropriate. And let's say that right. You ain't never supposed to be feeling good that you presenting like truth to the devil. How do that work in the sense of your theology? Like, right? No, you're supposed to beat the truth with it, but if that's something they say they're going to use against you, then see, we got to use think about appropriate. Also, we got to learn what the word betrayal really means. No, let's deal with what I said too, and we can question that. But let's deal with what betrayal really means. Betrayal is like presenting a truth to somebody, right, that would put them in harm's way, right? Well, see, that only, that often happens when we just use the truth inappropriately. Like, and so something we do in our subcultures is be like justified with saying, but it's true. So everything you know that you're saying, but it's true to, you already was out of pocket with all the stuff, the time you presented it. It's like saying something about somebody at their funeral that's true. But you know, that's an inappropriate truth at this moment because we at their funeral and they mourning, and you want to bring up what they did about something at the church. You know what I'm saying? And so that's just an example of what I was speaking on. You know what I'm saying?
Well, thanks for explaining that. Well, we got one more question. We already talked about that one. All right. Sorry. Yo, we're gonna play another joint before we get out of here. But real quick, before I ask you, before we do it, I want to ask you, if we're all said and done today, or if like someone found a Casual album or something on a Mars, or aliens came here and picked up a joint and saw your shit on it, like, I guess what I'm saying is, what's the legacy like that you'd like to leave behind with all this?
It got to do with the bars, you know what I mean? I think somebody really longevity, not even longevity in the sense of like staying on the top 50, no, just showing people like the normal person, like they could really, really have a humble hip hop life by always focusing on their craft, their artistry, trying to stay in good spirits, good morale. You can still be nice 30 years later, you know what I'm saying? And that's what I want people to get out of my contributions. You know what I'm saying? You ain't gotta fall off. Falling off is an old school thing or something that people choose to do. You know what I'm saying? That's what I would like, my legacy to be in independence and hip hop. You know what I mean?
I think you raise a good point though, man, as far as like, for some reason within rap and hip hop, it's like, as you get older or something, it's like all of a sudden you're just supposed to be whack. People are surprised when older cats put out dope stuff. And I'm like, yo, people still have to, if anything, you should be more sharp as you get older. I don't know, right? I mean, to me.
I mean, what the hell? This ain't sports, right? And so
you say.
Yeah, sports, you have physical deterioration. So you get a bum knee, 35, you ain't hopping as hard. What do you got in hip hop that's about to have you not spitting as many bars as you spit before? See, this is what happens. A lot of the time we come out, I ain't going to go too far. A lot of the time we come out and we get fluff on the shit they gave us, and then we lose the shit we gave us, so we ain't got no shit to rap about no more. Like, you know what I'm saying? If you came out, had your events, and you was living this one life, now you ain't living it, so you fell off and it's just ugly to you. No, it's a morale thing, but we can leave it at that. I think really keeping good morale and staying in good spirits is the key to being like a master rapper, you know?
Yeah, to me, you get more life experiences, you're growing, it seems like the vocabulary should grow. I mean, everything should grow. You should have more to rap about rather than less, right?
Like, exactly. I mean, exactly. And even, I think just a lot of us wasn't witty enough to attack the disses that young people will come with. But I'm one of them rappers. Like, you an old nigga. You got grays. I love some. I know how to flip all that back around and show that really is you trying to live to get to where I'm at right now. You know what I'm saying? And we should really be like learning how to lyrically express elder dominance when it comes to the microphone. You know what I'm saying?
Facts, yo. Like, if anything, y'all should be, it should be like the old dude on the court, like hitting threes, like all day.
Exactly.
Like, you know what I'm saying? They trying to yeah. check him, but they like, yo, how he got that handle? He's got the slow.
Exactly.
He burning them.
Yeah, exactly. Good enough.
Yo, we're gonna get on out of here. I want to joint to play Casual Art of Reanimation. This is episode 81 here in the Culture Show. Album just dropped today. You can get the vinyl just everywhere because you know how internet is. Just go get it. All the joints up. Yo, pick a joint. This is actually a real album. It's longer than 15 minutes.
Yep. Check out Below Systems. Check out Tough Kong. Let's see. What's the joint? I don't know. You got a list on it? I mean, I want one with a feature on it, like with one of the features.
How about with all these cats? You know, the whole crazy posse cut.
Okay, yeah, songs. Play the crazy. That joint crazy.
Let's play that.
All right, I appreciate you. And I'm about to listen from the audience, you know what I'm saying, if you don't mind. So thank you for having me, family member. You got me. Whenever you need anything, just tap in. It's good.
I appreciate you, man. We're going to see you. We're going to be out there for around September, like Labor Day. No matter, small Hiro Day, big Hiro Day, we out there regardless. So we're going to be out there. So
Yeah.
Thank you for everything, man. And we'll talk. I'll get this up on the YouTube. We're going to play this last joint. Got a bunch of home run hitters on here. Casual Hieroglyphics.
Yeah. Hey, y'all, stick around. Listen to this joint. I'm coming out there to listen right now.
All right. Salute, brother.
Peace.